So good evening, warm welcome to you all. The lecture tonight promises to be a special presentation by one of our leading design architects in Hong Kong, Gary Chang of Edge Design Institute. Before introducing tonight's speaker, allow me to give you a heads up for the other upcoming lectures this fall term. On Thursday this week, October 27, there will be a presentation by Deborah Koo on urban placemaking. Ms. Koo is an urban designer and landscape architect from Australia. She now works with the Development Bureau of Hong Kong Government. Her talk will be timely for those of you in studios such as U5 and I think some of the M1 studios as well, dealing with urban design placemaking issues. On November 10, Thursday, we will have a lecture by Linda Neary of Neary and Hu in Shanghai, a multidisciplinary practice that fuses design and research at all scales, from master planning and buildings to interiors and products and graphics. That's November 10. And then early in the spring term on March 2, also Thursday, David Adjaye from London will deliver the annual Kinoshita lecture. So please save the date for all three of these upcoming talks. Now I have great pleasure to introduce our guest speaker this evening, Gary Chang, who was born, raised, and educated in Hong Kong at Queen's College and Hong Kong U. He founded his own practice called Edge in 1994, which is now known as Edge Design Institute. So as the name implies, it is a research-based practice for innovative design, spanning from urban planning and architecture, to interiors and installations, to tableware and tea sets. His portfolio of work is recognized for influential design projects not only in Hong Kong, but also including China, Japan, Middle East, and Europe. And it goes well next month, US as well. One of his most celebrated projects is the transformation of his original family home, a flat of 32 square meters, which has been redesigned to accommodate 24 different room configurations. It is called the Domestic Transformer. How many of you have seen this YouTube? Have you seen it before, any of you? There are 840,000 viewers. I've seen it a few times myself. I learned something new each time, so I hope you'll see it tonight. For those of you designing micro-housing in your studio project, do pay close attention tonight. This project proves that you can think outside the box creatively while also staying very much within the box physically. In other words, one doesn't need to introduce a random angle or curve just to become innovative, but instead you dig down deep to examine and explore and experiment in order to mine for those hidden potentials. What I personally appreciate the most about this and other projects designed by Gary is that he does not turn his back to the challenge of an intrinsic problem. Rather, he deals with it straight on. He relies on thorough design research, as well as readiness to experiment with different strategies to inform his design direction. So you'll see in his own home, it's been a laboratory for ideas for many years, even decades. And so Gary identified a long-standing condition and flipped it on its head. So he questions, why do we need to move from one room to another, leaving others empty behind? Why not move the rooms around us? In turn, he takes his questioning even further to understand the relationship between the house and the city. With increasing urbanization and density, how does the city actually become an extension of our individual homes? So this attitude and approach by tonight's speaker reminds me of a famous quotation from literature and politics, but I think it's even more effective when applied to design. Several famous politicians have borrowed this quote it originates from the writer George Bernard Shaw, who asked this question: "You see things as they are and say, why? I dream of things that never were, and I ask, why not?" So I believe the greatest value of your formal education in architecture at our university is to apply your critical thinking and creative talents to these two questions, why and why not? And the greatest challenge of your professional career as architects will be the ability and perseverance not to let go of those questions in the face of hard realities, such as building regulations, conservative clients, maximizing GFA, etc. Frankly speaking, there are not many examples of leading architects in our city who have both the design talent and the determination to challenge conventional thinking in our model answer society. But tonight's speaker is one of them. Please extend a warm welcome to Gary Chang, whose presentation is titled "Compact Home, a Global Phenomenon."
Today, and very strange, I don't know why, although I was graduate from Hong Kong, but I gave quite a few lectures in CU instead. Hong Kong University never invited me to give a talk there. Maybe I'm a black sheep there. So anyway, I was invited by Nelson to give a talk here, I think two or three weeks ago, when I was in New Zealand. Having a holiday with my family. And in the last 2 weeks, I was reminded a few times that you should concentrate on compact home. So I think it's quite nice that we focus on one subject. So I won't bore you with our portfolio of work in the last 30 years. My office for 22 years and another professional years for 7 years after I graduated in the late 80s. So today I put my topic as a compact home. I know some of you are dealing with the projects, and I put my title as a suffix with the term a global phenomenon. So I'm not joking, because all through these years, after my latest transformation of my home in the year 2008, in the last 6 years, or 8 years, there's been almost non-stop inquiries all over the world coming to visit my home. And all the media coverage, I believe I have to collect all the media almost, yeah, from CCTV to New York Times, Financial Times, except, very strange, no media from Japan yet. Maybe they are very angry, because they are supposedly an expert in combat space as well. So I'm not joking, this has become a global phenomenon. And today also, in the last 2 years, we finally are able to have the chance to export our ideas outside Greater China. So I'll show you two recent projects. Also, one surprisingly is in Stockholm, another project is in Bangalore in India, which are related on a similar subject. So I really highly recommend that you spend more efforts in this subject, because I firmly believe that it has become a global phenomenon. I'd like to begin my talk with a short video actually done by Audi. Very strange, I did a lot of things accidentally. When I did my home, I didn't mean it's really a rigorous research. It's actually my own problem, because I say, some of you might know, I never moved my home. I've been staying in the same place for more than 40 years. Because I believe a decent architectural student or architect should experiment with their own home. So it's the most handy, but could be the most challenging as well. So why not experiment first with your own home? Yeah, even with a tight budget, you could do something interesting. So that's why I totally agree with Nelson that I should show all the process of change on my home in the last 40 years. I'm not joking. And in this last transformation, I really did quite spend a lot of money, almost like silly, because with the same amount of money, I could buy another apartment next door. But then I didn't realize that the reward is quite something, that Audi did a campaign for their Q3 a few years ago, the compact SUV, and they try to and they invite three spokesmen of all over the world as the spokesman for the launch, and actually three of them are guests, me from Hong Kong and Vic, and then one from Poland, Oscar. He did the airborne steel chair. So accidentally, actually to me this is my most ideal project at the moment. Someone I'll meet this time gave me a huge sum of money. I'm not joking. I can tell you actually $500,000 to send a crew from Sweden to spend 1 week in Hong Kong, take videos, coverage about my home and my projects, and broadcast the whole world, which is actually quite ideal. I don't mind to do a few more. So it's actually at the end quite rewarding as a result. So not too bad. So shall we start? So this is what they have done in the within the 1 week time, send a crew from Sweden. About the context of Hong Kong. And they asked me to speak in Cantonese, French.
Okay, hold on, I'm going to speak in Cantonese. I'm going to speak in Cantonese. 我家裡的朋友知道我家裡都看不出哪裡是牆，哪裡是部分是傢俬，因為我已經將它變成一個整體了，只要這樣你才可以覺得地方逼。我家裡大部分的牆，我沒什麼地方是不動的，很多地方可以推開，可以拉可以舉，經過這些推拉，我就可以變成不同的模式，來放我不同的物品。 對未來的世界，我諗越多人住喺呢個城市中心裏面，咁密集嘅地方，咁空間自然會越少。最覺得自由我屋企就係，只可以喺好細好有限嘅空間嚟做到每一樣基本嘅設施係大概一般人屋企可以擁有。咁所以我亦都將我屋企嘅嘢就翻咗喺香港裏面。 譬如一個三號站，我哋最近都啱做咗一個多層嘅住宅大廈，咁可以講到其實話更加出名，因為每一層得一個單位，而每個單位比屋企仲細。我諗其實 其實你需要幾大嘅地方先夠。喺好有限空間，其實一啲都唔會覺得唔舒服嘅。其實一個 intelligent 嘅空間咧，其實需要少啲地方就可以。Actually, I
did quite some efforts during the advertising campaign because I was on diet for 2 months at least before the production. So I'm quite professional actually. So, okay, so to begin with, I'll show you my home, the whole story. So it's roughly 32 square meters, but actually in reality, to be precise, it's 30.7 square meters because these days it's almost like a competition. It's getting smaller and smaller, so I have to be more precise sometimes. And I call it a massive transformer just because in the year 2007 it's a movie transformer, so I just follow the name and add the name domestic into it. So we are in Hong Kong, we know how tight the space is. And finally, Hong Kong has got one thing which is expertise which we might be able to influence the world to make it a compact space. And my home is actually on Island East, pretty close to Taikoo Shing. This is a very recent photo, by the way. It's not an old age photo, so it's quite a grumpy, gangster area kind of Hong Kong, but they are not cheap, actually, you know. So at the moment, my apartment costs around $3.5 million. But these days, you cannot find an apartment less than $3 million. I mean, very difficult. So this is like the minimum amount of money you need to buy an apartment in Hong Kong at the time. And as I said, I have been living in this space for 40 years around, and in the 70s, I believe, I called. And at the beginning, it's the home of my family, my parents and my sister and so on. But at the beginning, it's a for rental. And only a few years later that I began to purchase it on mortgage. So this is actually the lease condition, the plan. Actually, the building looks quite like a hotel, if you look more closely. Very funny. And this is the basic shape of the apartment. Roughly 4x8 to simplify. And then, actually, when you look more closely, those old buildings actually got some good advantage over the new one because they had the clever idea of having a light well in between two units. So to make sure that the corridor have natural ventilation and lighting, which is far superior than all these new buildings we have now, which we all suffocate without air conditioning or any kind of air movement. So this is, as a result, the apartment is small, but it got windows on both sides. One is facing your neighbor with a gap of like roughly 1 meter. So head on, totally. The bedroom facing the bedroom, the living room facing the living room, kitchen, head on to the kitchen, and bathroom head on the bathroom as well. And also one thing good about the old apartment is the bathroom and the kitchen are, again, far bigger than what we have these days. So very strange, we are not advancing in that respect. And one of the major inspiration we got is, oh, by the way, we have the plans of the earlier models, I mean. Yes, at the end, okay. Otherwise, Nelson will come to it. One of the major inspiration of my home is actually next door. I believe a lot of you know Tai On building, Tai On. So inside this huge building estate, they have a lot of shops that open and close every day. So the end is temporary, but after all these years, they are to be quite permanent. And you can see how many things they put inside and assemble and disassemble every day. It's a ritual. And all kinds of trays you can find within that space of the width of roughly about 1 meter or less. To me, this is very striking. They even put the floor inside because some of the floors are not level. So it's the year 1976 when the story began. And again, we are living in the same space. And this is one of the sketches I did. I did quite a lot of sketches, I remember, in those days. And I think I was in primary to secondary school, around primary school. Basically, it's the year 1974, actually. And at the time, so living in such a tight space is not easy. I don't mean it's nice. Yeah, it's very challenging. If you are not in good relationship with your family, then there will be a homicide, suicide, easily. So never easy. So at the same time, that's why to me this is not an interest. To me, it's a necessity. I really need to know how to make my life a bit better. So sometimes I dream. So that's why even during the primary school, I draw sketches of the floor plan. And this is one of the only remaining four sketches I got because my mother threw them all away. Because of the lack of space. You know, mother love to throw things away easily without your permission. Otherwise, I could have a book published with all the sketches. But this one is actually quite interesting because I try to imagine, our home is really too small. What would happen if I got the neighbor? So I add a bridge and then put my parents to a better room facing the harbor. And then unfortunately, I have three young sisters. Yeah. So even though I'm a boy, but somehow with three sisters, though I never got always the privilege, even though I didn't have quite a lot of privilege being a boy. So So this is a good chance to torture my younger sisters. I put them all into a very cramped room and put myself in a better room. But back to reality. Reality is the half of the science, of course. And with this kind of space, there are actually three rooms at the beginning. I believe you can read. They are altogether three rooms. And actually, this is in the 70s, but I'm not joking. Unfortunately, it's quite difficult to visit some homes now. But actually, nowadays, in the same building, some units are still divided into three rooms, and one room is one family. I have a neighbor that obliquely across my home, which have three families from East Asia. So all the Indian cooking, which I can experience every day almost. So actually, we are not talking about our family. We are talking about three families these days, yeah, even more times than before. And of course, the corner room is reserved for my parents. The second room is reserved for my three young sisters. And then we have one more room. Doesn't belong to me, unfortunately, didn't. We sublet to an outsider to get more money. So we have actually one stranger in my home. Yeah. Actually, do you know I did publish a book about my apartment? And something you'll never forget. Like, I remember the smell of this neighbor after coming out from the toilet. Yeah, because it's so smelly. And then, I didn't have my own room, of course. I slept in the living corridor. It's not a living room, I think it's a corridor, to be more precise. And at that time, all the furniture are transformable, multi-purpose. You know, the chairs are folding. The bed, so-called bed, is actually a bench in daytime. But actually, one thing which trained me to become architect is during the early years is and I had to learn to sleep very late because I had to wait for everyone to go to bed before I could. Because the living room is my temporary bedroom. So this is all measure drawing done for the book. Unfortunately, I didn't do any drawing at that time, and even any photos. So this is rough the idea how the same space with three rooms is talking about. And this is very important image about all these folding chairs and folding bench. All the tables are expandable, of course. And there's something that I think is not we are not improving because in those days all the tables are transformable, and these days the tables are maybe more beautiful, but there are few people use it actually. Everybody escaped to their own room. And in those days, all the tables are we just have one table actually, but they are multi-purpose. Depending on different activities, we put different table finish on top, like adding a cardboard for mahjong, for dining, for working, for studying, and even a light industry. Ask your mom, yeah, and parents. Yeah, in those days in the 70s, every family, most family, have some kind of light industry at the home, either plastic flower or assembling toys, plastic toys. I still remember the torture. So at that time, the tables are multi purpose. But not anymore. And then 1 year later, in the 80s, I graduated in the year 87. And then after graduation, I got a scholarship to Europe as a prize for being naughty. So I just got a beer pass in the school. So for those who got distinction, don't be happy so soon. It might only help you to get your first job, but that's it. But if you got a near past, doesn't mean that you don't have a future. Yeah, it all depends, yeah, on your efforts later. So don't, to me, it doesn't matter too much. Yeah, depends. Yeah. For me, it doesn't affect anything. So the year after graduation, I'm quite lazy. I asked my mother, during the travel grant to Europe for 2 months, I asked my mother to find me a room. So can you guess what room that she found in the end? It's exactly one floor above their bunk. So actually, we are practically still living together. And then after 1 year, in the year 88, I don't know for what reason, but my family moved to another place. Maybe I now recall, they lived together with my grandparents. Yeah. And then at the time, my Actually, I'm quite lazy. I never plan my own life. So at again, it's my mother who suggests me to keep the room, stay in this apartment. And at the time, well, I don't have any budget, of course. I share the apartment with my best friend in school and a colleague in the office. So we two share the apartment for 1 year. And you can see how the lack of experience we got, because we just graduated 1 year, so not much practical experience. One thing we forgot, very important about Thai space, is someone should spend some time to study this subject, which is quite very important for combat space, is acoustic. Because with so many people living together, yeah. I remember in the old days, my parents and my sisters, we learned to speak very softly, almost whispering. Could you imagine if everyone yelled at each other? we will have the focus on very soon, yeah. So, when I shared this apartment with my best friend, life turned out to be not just two people, but three, sometimes four. sometimes more than four, yeah, for different reasons. And then, I'm not joking, we feel like, visually we are separated, but we feel like we are in bed together. So actually this is one of the biggest challenges for living in a tent space, is acoustic isolation. Yeah. Never easy, of course. But we're studying, okay? If you have a smart idea, I think you've got extension. Very challenging. So within that year, I found out life is too difficult. So I kicked them out. And this is a measure drawing again. So because why is no acoustic value? Because all the walls are just furniture. Yeah, we like playing jigsaw puzzle. Using existing furniture to organize it three-dimensionally as if it's like a toy. But it got no value acoustically, unfortunately. And that's the measure drawings. Mostly they are bookshelves from the local shops, which are even cheaper than IKEA. So after I kicked my neighbors out, after the torture for 1 year, so finally I have my own apartment, which is a real luxury. So even without much decoration, to me it's like a paradise already. So 2 years after graduation, I did my own apartment first time. I call it a gray labyrinth because, again, I don't have any budget doing anything. So I tried to make like a maze, a labyrinth out of my apartment. So this is I still have the copy of this early sketch that you enter from above and passing through a kind of gallery and through another spot into the main space. And then my bed's actually hidden inside this niche. This is the bathroom, this is the kitchen. But the plan looks quite simple, but it worked quite well because some of my friends couldn't recognize where the bathroom. They always went to the kitchen. The bathroom is here, but they always go out here. So sometimes, because with the bottles of wine, yeah. I think physically it's because of that. So actually this labyrinth worked quite well. Even with such a tight space, you can do labyrinth. Of course, we all know the advantage of labyrinths. The place feels much bigger than reality because you have all these trees and turning corners. With amoeba and so on. Again, using existing furniture bought from the nearby shops, so it's the minimum budget. You can do it easily now. Yeah, even when you are studying, I believe you got the budget of doing expanding your home with this furniture. So the interior, the architectural intervention become actually more like a furniture intervention. This is the gallery. And you see that all the bookshelves are organized vertically and horizontally. Only one thing is they have to paint on all six sides because of that. I think the contractor is extremely angry about it. Normally because you know the furniture are painted only on the front and most equate the side, but not at the back at least. It's like a parade of all the furniture. So finally I have a few photos about the place. Yeah, the idea is you don't see the entire space. It's almost like the language of Chinese garden. You have to chase the turning corner so that the home looks bigger than usual. And then The fourth transformation is done 10 years later, in the year 1998. And then this year is quite personal to me because I broke the partnership with my former colleague, former partner, in that year. And it's quite, to me, up till now, the most challenging project to break the partnership, because to me, it's even more difficult than a divorce. Because you still have the more than 10 colleagues, and with the project, it's very complicated. So, some kind of retail therapy. I remember in that week, single week, I bought a lot of clothes, I don't know, just to calm down. I remember I went to the Jewel Center shop and I like one shirt and I said, what other color do you have? And then at the end of that week, I realized I still didn't spend enough money to calm me down, so I found that I had to decorate my home. Very strange idea, but it's true. So finally, I did transform my home again just because of that. So in this transformation, I call it the flexible curtains, which is actually done very quickly within 2 months' time, and with a limited budget also, not too expensive. But this time is the first time that I totally transformed my home. And at this stage, I have the idea of, if the space is so small, you still have a lot of things you need to put inside to be a fully equipped home. And at that time, I already started at the idea of putting all the necessity into two zones, like two parallel walls. The thinner one on one side and the thicker one on the other side. And at that time, I still have a kind of a bathroom. And otherwise, the entire space is totally open. And all the time, I'm always like designing watches, like doing all kinds of measurements. You know. To me, in a tight space, all the measurements count. You know. It's like almost like designing a watch. And as a result of this, in this stage, the transformation is quite straightforward by movable curtains. So by opening and closing the curtains, I could have at least 8 different scenarios. So the concept was very straightforward. Everything covered by curtains. So that's the end result. Done very quickly and easily. I think at the time I started to stay in hotels and I think somehow influenced by Phil Stark. You know, Phil Stark is very expert in doing using curtains to bring about a dreamscape in the hotel rooms. I think at the time I'm obsessed with the hotels already. Remind me to talk about hotels, which is to me quite related. Because one reason why I'm not joking actually, even up to now, I have only one home, the same home. I never buy another apartment in Hong Kong. Maybe that's the reason why I can sleep well. And also another thing is why I can stand such a small apartment, because these days I spend more than 70% traveling. 70%, I mean. So actually I stay in hotels more than 70% of the time. So actually, for me it's more convenient to stay in a small home, because I actually take care of my home by myself. I never hide and make. So if you give me a much bigger home, I don't know what to do. And actually, that's also a reason why I have another obsession into hotel rooms. Yeah. And sometimes, to me, as Desmond said, I'm a very practical person. My interests are all developed among things that I must do. So since I have to stay in hotels, why not make it a study? And interesting enough, hotel rooms, at least in Greater China, in China, there's a big development of compact home as well in China. And then my clients always ask me, can you help me to design a hotel room like apartment? So to them, small home mean hotel rooms. So because they got a lot of inspiration from hotels. So to me, to some extent, it's quite true. Okay, back to my home. So you can realize that I start to be influenced by my daily routine or yearly routine, that I spend more and more time in hotels. And I turn my home almost like a hotel in some respect. And the place is quite open, quite straightforward, but depends on different lighting, your home totally transformed. So one thing important, as I said earlier, is acoustics, which is very attractive. The second thing to me is kind of a pros. Doing a tight home is by using lighting. Because by a split of a second, your home is totally transformed simply by lighting into different booths. You know, maybe some of you have stayed in some hotels, they always have some hotels have wood lighting, yeah. That's in level 1, 2, or 3, even though both of them fail to be. I can't see the difference. But if you're done, but it is done nicely, the place is really transformed, you know, just by lighting. Actually, another habit is quite interesting. Is I have a sofa bed, quite support with wheels. So it depends on which place I move the bed, because with the wheels, I can do it easily. And the experience living in this home is quite different. You can experiment with that, yeah, putting wheels on the bed, which is quite easy to try. And then my home actually had only one window facing the outside. But then at that time, I already had the idea that it should be multi-purpose. So it became a home theater. And again, it's the one subject, double purpose. This is another important strategy for combat space. So that guy went away. So one object with two use. So I don't have a blackout curtain for the window because the blackout curtain is actually the movie screen, yeah, which can serve a blackout purpose. And even though the screen is actually not really big, but then since my room is so small, it feels very big. So I think these days also a lot of people lost the sensitivity of scale. So it's all about relativity, yeah. So even in a tight space, sometimes you could feel huge or grand. Because take for this example, because the screen occupies the entire wall without anything else, so you feel it's big, yeah. Even though it's not actually. So it's all about psychology actually. The other thing, I don't know to what extent you can try, but you can try to work about psychology. Psychology is one thing which could be very detrimental in doing a combat space as well. Because for real experience, you know, it's not just about the physical dimensions. Sometimes it's the psychological aspect which could totally transform the perception about, say, something very classical, which we almost forget. Yeah. Actually, the lighting is also psychological, by the way. Acoustics is something that you don't see. Yeah, don't spend too much time on things you see only because they are not totality. Yeah. A lot of things you can do without the eyesight. Yeah. So to me, this is a very straightforward idea, covering things, all the things by curtains. And depends on which part you open or close, your home becomes very different. So again, during this transformation, I already had the idea that I don't move. The home moves on me, yeah. So I don't divide the home into different compartments. It's just one big space. In the idea of loft in the truest sense. So you cannot tell which part is a living room, which part is a bedroom. Yeah. But even now, these days, a lot of people, developers, and so on, still obsessed with the idea of, in the language of the Japanese, is LDK. Yeah. So the number start LDK, I believe you should know. LDK meaning the living room, dining room, and kitchen. So it's like essential. Yeah, your home must be defined by how many number of bedrooms and then followed by living room, dining room, kitchen, as it is a must. But in our project, you'll see that we try to break that boundary. So you never see where is the actual kitchen, where is the actual living room, where is the actual bedroom. It's all in the one space. But it's more than that, I'll tell you later. In this transformation, I did my bathroom also open. But the good advantage is, since it's open, so I could still watch the movie from the bathroom, which is quite a luxury. So bathroom is not just a bathroom. This only happens when it got built, completed on the first day, you know. Well, talking about this, this is another very big challenge. I don't know the project you're working on is just about the apartment itself or about the entire project. Because I can tell you the most difficult things to doing a complex home is how to place, where to place your own possessions. Yeah. So even no matter if you are rich or poor, you still have a lot of stuff. You are poor, maybe you have more stuff because you don't want to throw away unless your mother have you. So everyone, I think, have a lot of stuff there. Yeah. Piling up at home, yeah. But even if your home is big, it's still piling up. So the solution is sometimes it is a architectural project, like the project I'm going to show you in Stockholm. The developer had the idea of Yeah, of course, another big storage space in the basement so that you can have your own things put there, usually for bigger items. But then, putting the storage in the basement of the same building is relatively still quite convenient, yeah. But if you don't, if you put in other parts of the district, like those small container, storerooms, things, denominations, which to me is, of course, it's just for stuff you don't want to use, yeah. But for stuff you need to use, it's quite a challenge, yeah. Even putting in the basement sometimes still not convenient enough. But unfortunately, your home is that small, so how can you do it? It's not easy. It's actually the most challenging. I'm still learning after all these years how to organize my home, I mean, my own possessions. Even though I can put in all the things, bathroom, so on, but still, I still have too many stuff. Luckily, I'm a big office. Yeah. You're welcome to have a visit. Because I don't know how long I'll stay there because the rent is so high. But I have to admit, nowadays, over 90% of my books are in the office, not in my home. And half of my wardrobe is in the office. So yes, there's a way out. But talking about this stage, the bathroom, the totally open bathroom. So I just have a curtain there, covering the bathroom when needed, and I have friends here. But then, another very strange thing, you never know your friends. You thought you know them very well, but actually, sometimes it's very interesting. Because like, yeah, some of my friends don't even bother to close the curtain. I don't mean just two people, but like group people, yeah. And usually the trick is, for me, is when my friends go to the bathroom, we close the curtain and raise the volume of the hi-fi system. It's like a Japanese style. But then, I'd actually turn it off so that we could hear clearly what's happening behind the curtain. Another just thing of the layout is, I'll go back to the plan, is that you must pass through the kitchen before going to any places. So it is going to be quite obligatory. Sometimes kitchen is part of the room, but to me it's like the first stop of your apartment. You have to pass through it before you enter in any other parts. So this is my entrance foyer, which become a kitchen. And then I stack my stuff, try to organize it better in a vertical datum. So at a certain level, it's a similar subject. So hopefully to make it more structured and less easy. But this only worked for the first week, of course. So storage system is still another complicated thing you will learn for your entire life, at least. If you remember, you should bring your idea to the next slide, because you'll spend at least a lot organizing all your possessions. Someone look like the buildings outside. Okay, in the year 2007, I just went back from Shanghai for a business trip, and then when I entered the corridor of the building, I realized it's kind of flooded, because water started to seep out from my apartment. On the water system actually, which consists of seawater. So it's a mess. So at first I'm extremely angry, of course, but then in less than 3 minutes I felt quite happy, because this is a good excuse for me to transform my home again. So that's the reason. So actually I did a lot of things without actual planning, actually. You know, it's all accidental. So it depends on, so the idea is you encounter something, good or bad, and then you try to admit it, as Nelson reminded me earlier, that I always accept the problem and see what I can do. Yeah. So life is never ideal, of course. I believe you know that now. Yeah. So in the year 2007, I did my last transformation. So it's like a summary of all the transformation in the last 40 years. And this time, as I said, domestic transformer. And I spent 1 year doing this project, so it's not joking. So entire year doing this tiny apartment, 6 months doing the design, 6 months for the renovation. And this, I still work on sketches, yeah. So maybe TC is already in the computer, but I never used it. This, by the way, this is my former classmates in University of Hong Kong. So I still do sketches, and the nice thing is they carry me all the time. Yeah. Sometimes get wet, so it's almost like Jesus Christ. Okay. And you can see most of the time I'm struggling with the dimensions again. Yeah. because I don't want every millimeter to be placed. So this is almost like a watch design. And this is the final result. Again, it's got inspired from the earlier transformation. I divide all my process, all the furniture I need into two different zones. One is 550, one is 900. Yeah. So you have to really learn about everything you need at home and see how you could organize them. For me, I organize it into two zones. 550 for the smaller furniture like tables and wardrobe. Actually, 550 is a compromise. You know, wardrobe should be 600. So actually, I learned the mistake. Yeah, so my clothes are not too happy these days. This is just because of that 50 mm. Yeah. And then the other zone is 900, which consists of the kitchen, the bathtub, and the toilet. Yeah. 900 is like the norm. Yeah. But then the other very important thing is exactly half the size of my home is empty. And you know practically why I need my home, half of my home empty. So this is the important concept drawing of my home. Then the yellow parts are all moving. So most parts of my home is moving. So when you visit my home, so please don't lean on anymore. They are all moving. So as a result of the moving wall, basically the transformation is done by moving wall on tracks on the ceiling. So I could have at least 24 scenarios. Like a party for 20 people, I'm not joking. For movies, for 8 people to have a good sight line, and so on and so forth. And then, strange enough, I didn't say that I'm 24 scenarios, I said I'm at least. But then somehow the media tried to describe my home as a home with 24 transformation. Yeah. So actually, when you, I have a lot of experience talking to the media, the interview. So. When you try to, actually it's like a presentation, communication, you have to find a way to tell people in a very short time what it's all about, actually like a quiz. Yeah. Actually it's not just a quiz, it's actually like the heading of your project. Because the title suggests a lot of things and you know, most people are very busy and I think some of you are very busy also, you just want to read the title. So. The best is contain essential items in the title. It's the best way, especially when you enter competitions. Yeah. Title is very important, not just a title. Yeah. The best title always carries the best important message. And that's it. Even reading a title almost like read your whole skin yeah, sometimes, especially if it's an idea competition. Yeah. So important. At least the catch your eye, first eyesight yeah, among thousands of submissions. Okay, so this is the final result, which I presume some of you have seen already. So this is then transformed to a kind of bench. And by the way, you notice also, of course, my home is tinted yellow. Because you can see now my home is like a rear window, each one moving. I face the back of the building. So instead of facing the harbor, I face a lot of neighbors, which I actually enjoy. I can peep into my neighbors than peeping the harbor. Yeah, it's more fun. There's bound to be something happening. I tell you the truth, you see? It's actually quite entertaining. But then the content is, but you know this is reality. Yeah, I'm sure you know Hong Kong situation, and especially if you go to Jumper Hall. Yeah, you're bound to face your neighbors, yeah. Yeah, all the buildings are at least 50 stories up. Yeah. So you have to start to get accustomed to the view like this and try to turn it into advantage. But of course, it's still quite harsh seeing all these neighbors all the time. And I have a habit of not closing my curtain. Even if I stay in hotel, I hate closing curtain because in a place where when you close the curtain, the place feels very depressed and suffocating. So actually, curtain is. Or the way to adjust the amount of light or visitor from a compact home is actually quite important subject as well. Because with natural light, actually a lot of places you feel better because of the presence of natural light. Yeah. So be careful about how you do the demonstration. It may help a lot. And for me, I always want to have the full view of my neighbors. So. Yeah, actually don't need TV, the view outside is more interesting. Real life Hong Kong, yeah. And then, but then still sometimes looks depressing, seeing the neighbor all the time. So I tint my window yellow with a yellow film in between. So that, because I did this in many projects in our studio, in other commercial project or exhibition. Something you can easily, you buy a film and then put it on the window, big enough so that you can feel the ambience. Suddenly, it become almost like a painting, very strange. You feel it's kind of isolation, separation between what's inside, what's outside, with just applying the tint. It suddenly become like a still movie, yeah. You can try, and it worked very well. You should try, yeah. And so as a result, my home is tinted yellow all the time. And I call it the sunglass effect, so that actually when the weather is gloomy, my home is still shiny. When it's shiny, my home is like sparkling golden yellow. Because when I buy eyeglass, I prefer the yellow tinted, brown tinted, brown and the gray tinted, which are all look very different. So it's like my home wearing a sunglass. No, it seems that I'm like exploring all possibilities to make my home feeling better. So you have to do the same thing in the project, I believe. So again, I still keep the concept of the curtain as the using the screen as a curtain. I still have the TV in the movie because the TV is normally more for news program. And then watch what's happening. The wall of the TV can move. So when you slide the TV wall out, you discover my kitchen. So this is very important because that means with this transformation, you are not designing, you are not optimizing the space, you are optimizing the time as well. So in the same space, depending on different time, it's for different purpose. Yeah. And when I don't need the kitchen, it occupies minimal space. And also because of this sliding wall, one thing very interesting is I could make my kitchen bigger, smaller. It's actually not just two modes. Like in the morning when I just make a coffee, I don't need the kitchen to be in this situation. I could have the wall slightly open. It's good enough already. Oh, by the way, it leads to another very important example, which is an important factor about how to make your home feeling bigger or better is yourself. You should slim down yourself. Yeah. When you're asleep, your home is much bigger. Yes, all this space allowance are pretty very different. Depends on whether you are like this or that. Yes, one experience I stayed is in London. It's called the Sweet West in Bayswater, designed by Apple. Actually, you know London, so expensive, the hotel. I actually booked a junior suite. It's actually 28 square meter. So 28 square meter hotel room can be called a suite. Can you imagine? And luckily, I'm not too big. So because I remember the corridor to the bathroom next to the bed is that wide. So if you are like this, you cannot go to the bathroom. So I'm not joking. So, like your home, yeah. If you are a slimmer, so your home will be much more tolerable. To me, the future of mankind is paper thin. So. Zero dimension, so can go anywhere. You might be bulky, but thin, yeah, like paper thin. So I encourage you to draw yourself in your project, or it depends on whether it's your home or something. You should assume. The size of the cut of the guest or the end user, maybe. It will make your project more convincing. Okay, this is very straightforward, the walk-in closet. Again, inspired from hotel. So when I open the wall, it glows by itself. By the way, as I said earlier, this is not a budget project, it's a hugely luxurious project. It cost me $1.6 million to do the renovation. It's not just the material, but also because the labor cost in Hong Kong is so expensive that since this is kind of really an experiment, yes, it's very challenging, even for the contractors, of course. So they need to spend 6 months. You can imagine the price of the labor, 6 months doing things in Hong Kong. So this will lead to another important subject. Actually, I will tell you the result coming out from our, you could say, research. That one very important thing is prefabrication. If you consider a subject isn't enough, it depends on the context. But actually, this is actually not just for this project, of course, because prefabrication and is such a big phenomenon. Because these days, when I did projects abroad, they never question. They always ask me, what's the best place to do the manufacture, and where's the, no matter where. So it's already get accustomed to all the developers. They don't imagine things must be done in the same place. Yeah, they are already researching places which got the, of course, the least expensive budget. Yeah. So furniture could be done, or even more could be done for a project in New York, but done in India. China, is, as you know, as you should know, is never got a full advantage, because you can get nice things done in Thailand, or actually even in Stockholm, in Sweden. The project, the mock-up was done in northern Sweden, which is, to our surprise, is very cheap. Yeah. So never imagine Europe's all expensive. Yeah. It really depends. Yeah. So prefabrication is very important. I mean, even though it sounds very practical, but maybe the professors will appreciate your efforts in making the project more realistic. Yeah. So instead of doing things on site, you better think about off-site construction, especially for mass-produced projects. Yeah. It's the must, actually. Another thing is the table. Oh, by the way, the other tricks I want to play a game in this apartment, this transformation is, besides putting everything inside, I want everything bigger than usual also. This like, kind of game, yeah. So that means no compromise. Even though the space is small, but I want really every part bigger than usual. So for instance, for the table, it's 2.2 meter long. So I think not too many people have a table that long. Yeah. And it can swing out like a Swiss Army and become a table for dinner for 5 people. Yeah. Yeah, especially it's 5 for instance. <the room. laughs> And then the other thing is, like the shower, it is almost the only thing that is not designed, is a product. And it's 1.29 by 1.29 meters. It's like huge. The price of a car. You got the color therapy, steam, massage, everything, yeah. But it's huge, you can see. It's like bigger than most people's home. Yeah. I mean, in terms of shower. Actually, this is my first. This is not my first idea. My initial idea is to have the double shower, which is like 50% bigger. I want everyone, my friends, including me, to shower before going to the apartment. But it's a bit too much, I think. So, last transformation, you must enter the kitchen. This transformation, you must enter the shower. Actually, it's like in some science fiction movie already. At least two, I can recall. But later, I kicked up the idea. This is too much, maybe. But then look at this huge wall, which I got most complaint from this wall. I read the comments on the internet. Most people complain, oh, why you still need this 3,000 compared to this? Yeah, these days it's so silly. On one hand, you're talking about your home is so small, but why you still keep 3,000 compared to this? To me, it's like an order to me. I'm still old fashioned, unfortunately. Yeah, I can easily put those into my amplifier, of course, but I still want the physical things. To me, it's like the artwork of the home. Yeah. It's heavy, of course, you know. But this wall can move as well. Once you move out, it's a second wall, which contains lots of storage. Actually, it's quite a dilemma, very strange. On one hand, I said I don't have enough space to put all my possessions. I'm still learning. But on the other hand, a lot of shelves are still quite empty. So that's why it doesn't match very well. Yeah. It's not that easy. Even after thinking for the same subject for 1 year, I still didn't know myself good enough. So this is another trend for come back home. You have to, if I don't know the project, if it's for yourself, maybe, I don't mean it's easy, it's actually very difficult. And you will reveal how much you know yourself. But then if it's for the general layman, yeah, it could be easier, but you never know. Yeah. It's difficult to have one thing that suits all purpose, all people. I think it's very difficult, I think. And then it leads to another observation when we did our projects, because it's always a challenge. Later, I will show you our latest project. It's, actually, you can visit now in Hong Kong, yeah. the 15 square meter apartment. Yeah, for Henderson. And it's 15. Yeah, don't ask me to do anything smaller. To me, it's already like, I want to kill myself almost. It's so difficult. 15 square meter. But it's always a dilemma that whether you want a fully furnished apartment or halfly or partially furnished apartment. For the project in Stockholm, it's partially furnished. For this Henderson project, it's fully furnished. Because to me, if it's a large scale project for mass production, I think it's quite surreal to have every apartment the same because everybody has different idea of what their home to be. So to me, it's more realistic for the Stockholm project that we did part of the home, only furnished part of home, and we did some like 40% of space for individual interpretation. To me, it's more realistic and more flexible. Okay, after the two walls, I had the bathtub. In origin, I have a guest room here as a, also as a, as a single bed. But later discovered it's not, it's redundant because it's a friend here, it'll be my partner. Yep. So you don't need another bed actually. So later I get rid of the guest room. And but then you wonder why all this huge amount of storage space, actually normally they sit on top of the bathtub, you see. So that's why it's empty here. And it's again a very important time-based design because even though I like the bath, I use it like half an hour or 45 minutes at most. Yeah, you don't want to take the bath for more than 1 hour, I mean, it's quite dangerous. So the rest of the time you're not using the space. So you can see how big the space above the occupy in such a compact space. So actually, I didn't invent this idea myself. Actually, I got inspiration from movies. And this inspiration is from an Icelandic movie, 101, Reykjavik 101. Yeah. 101 is the postal code of the oldest part of the city of Reykjavik. And this movie is called 101 Reykjavik, you can check. Yeah. And in one scene of the movie, the character, the son, talked to his mother at home, sitting on the sofa. But then in the second minute, he flipped the sofa and then become a bathtub. And continue the conversation with the mother, but with him in the bathtub. So I got inspired by that. So I put things, activities above the bathtub. This time it's all this storage space, which save most of my space for storage. Otherwise it's so difficult. And there's another one, which is quite small, like almost like a column. By the way, this is details, yeah. This is actually the first part I designed at the beginning, is the handle. Because I realized that if I don't do the handle nice enough, I'll never want to pull the wall, yeah. I'm quite lazy also, as you know, as I said repeatedly said that. So I designed the handle at the very, very beginning to be comfortable enough so that you are encouraged to use the handle to pull the wall. So this little wall is hiding my laundry space behind, which is in the middle of the home. So normally in the home you have the back of house or service area on the side, but in my home it's in the middle. Yeah, it doesn't matter to me because I wash my clothes almost every day, so it's quite convenient. And then by the way, the empty clothes are on the other side. These are actually shelves for the clean clothes. So you don't need to walk to your bedroom. Actually, my another argument is I save a lot of energy by having my footprint of my home so small. Actually, after the New York Times, I think before the New York Times, the first media who interviewed me is actually a TV program from Canada, the greenest home in the world. At first, actually, when they invited me, I'm kind of happy. I don't know why. It's not my intention to make my home green, but of course, you know, the biggest message of my home is the minimum footprint, so it's reduced again. So by reducing the footprint, you will actually easily, directly save a lot of energy already. So again, back to the subject of one object, two purpose. So my shower actually functioned as a telephone booth during the parties. It's quite practical, actually. Yeah, it's the, yeah, you know, yeah, no need to explain. And since my home is so empty, actually now I feel my home is a bit too big. Maybe I could subdivide and sublet the other half. Okay, that may be the main cause of my next transformation, to reduce my home into half and sublet the other half. So, well, realizing my home is so empty, I could put a hammer. Actually, when I did the Stockholm project, you know, Scandinavia, they got so many shops for camping. So I bought actually a shelter as a guest room now. Yeah. So if you visit my home, if you don't want to sleep with me, you can sleep in the shelter, like a tent, in the middle of the home. Yeah. Again, it's actually inspired from a movie, you know, the Japanese movie, I forgot the name. With the lost switching of the powers. Yeah, the end part of the scene of the movie is the family try to pretend to be camping inside their home. They put the tent in a living room, yeah. Which is actually a very handy idea. Okay, so after my home, Yeah, I'll continue quickly. So this is kind of a summary observation. To me, the new age of city dwellers all over the world is talking about compact space. You need to be innovative. I'm afraid you have to be smart as well. Otherwise, your life will be very difficult. And kind of affordable also. That's the main challenge. But then actually, after saying this, is another direction of compact home. It's compact, but expensive. It happens in New York, London, and Hong Kong, of course. All through these years, I did a little simple statistics. Most places approach me a lot are from New York and London and India. India is about average size families, but from London, New York is talk about small but expensive, yeah. And I'm afraid this is also pioneered by Hong Kong, as you know now, we all know, yeah. Hong Kong is the most extreme case, very small but crazily expensive. And other areas try to follow this idea, and somehow we are at the forefront again, we are the pioneer. I think it's not just me. Because I think you know some of the others, the other is Lab Architects? Lab, yeah. Also did a comeback of very interesting one. So somehow we got something we are pretty proud of, that we are like the pioneers in doing nice, smart, comeback home. Not the Japanese, because the Germans are small, but very depressing. And they have a very individual, unusual aesthetic about space, about color, about materials. Yeah, not everybody agree. Yeah, so something very essential to me. So somehow we are, and I think in terms of size of area, if you talk about 15 square meter, we are really leading the global phenomenon. Yeah, because if you talk about other areas, they are still talk about around 30 square meter. They never mention 15. 30 is to them is very small. But we are now talking about 15, half the size. And this is a kind of summary of what we observe after all these projects. I only show the topic because I don't want to tell you the whole story, because otherwise you don't need to do anything. So I hope I'm allowed to show this. Just an approach. First is maximizing the use of volume. So volume meaning that you are not maximizing the floor plan. But actually, I believe my dear colleagues also agree. When I teach in the university, I hate to see students showing me floor plans all the time. Yeah, even on the first day. Yes, we are talking about space. Space is not just about floor plans. Yeah. So it's three-dimensional, remember. You have to maximize not the floor plan, but the whole volume. Second thing is optimizing the elements of construction. This is very important because since the home is so small, if you reduce the elements of construction like the wall, you can save a lot of space. The most straightforward example is the wall, which you can use a glass laminate. I got this idea from hotels again, because in a lot of hotels, when they do the bathroom, they always enclose the bathroom by glass laminate. So we are talking about less than 1 cm, like 8 mm, and you got a decent wall, which is rigid enough for the purpose. Compared with a normal wall with tiles, you need at least 100 mm. Yeah, you save 90% of space already, just simply by the construction. So for those who are serious enough, I highly recommend you to look into the elements of construction as a result. The third is compact organization of this, that means you have to know further deep into what you need at the home. So a home, again, is not, if someone tell me I want to organize the kitchen, living room, bedroom, I will give them a straight bedroom because you won't answer the problem, because home is not consisting of kitchen, bathroom, and living room. At least you should tell me your home is about brushing the teeth, even sleeping, resting on the bed is not good enough. So unless you look into your life deep enough, otherwise you cannot have any innovation to me. Yeah. So don't tell me that you are designing a bedroom or kitchen anymore. Yeah. I'll give you a straight frame. So that's the reason why I don't teach now. Because yeah, I'm very harsh. Okay, the fourth point is more generous furniture in the space. So this is kind of my own agenda. Maybe because my background is mathematics, so I always believe the magic of numbers. Yeah, you never know the idea of a finite and infinite. Yeah, maybe in the finance area, you could still have infinite possibilities. Yeah. So never compromise at the beginning. Even you have a small space, at least you should try your efforts to make some bigger furniture. And it actually, I proved that it worked in many projects. The fifth element is time-based again, so it's very straightforward. Other architectural interior or furniture transformation. Yeah. So you are designing, not just optimizing, not just space, but also the time. The sixth is very straightforward, as I recall in the olden days, most furniture are multifunctional. So an object with more than one purpose. Seven is about elements that can move. Yeah, as you see, it helps a lot. I think the trolley is one of the most handy piece of furniture at a compact home because you can move anywhere. Yeah, even to the bathroom. Actually, that's also like inspired by hotels, because once I stayed in a hotel in Singapore called Wanderlust. In one, all the levels are different design. On the lowest level, that means the most expensive room. They call it, I forgot. Yeah, the name of the room, but I felt like I slept in a bathroom with a bed, so I can't stand it. On the same day, I changed my room. So somehow it, but then it's the good thing about it is, yeah, the innovation of this room is, why not? You have a big bathroom and you put a bed, so you serve most of the purpose, and you have a big bathroom, why not? Some people will enjoy the bath a lot, so why not turn the entire room into predominantly a bathroom, and you start to put things inside the bathroom. Kitchen, cooking stove, and so for me it's a mini bar, of course. Oh, there's actually another inspiration from Park Hyatt Milan, because Park Hyatt is like the top brand of the Hyatt family, so most expensive brand for Hyatt, and normally the rooms are huge, but then for Milan, the rooms actually only 32 square meters for the classic room, so. One thing they got a very smart idea is, in the bathroom, it's actually occupying half the space and it's huge. Very strange, 32 square meter, but then you got a huge bathroom. But once you look at the bathroom more closely, you find your wardrobe is actually inside the bathroom. And this is one example I try to demonstrate, that what you do in a home could be related in a different way. Because, especially if you start doing luxury home, you start to know, actually, bathroom and wardrobe are interrelated activities, they are not separate. If you have this is one possibility, is to put the wardrobe inside the bathroom, why not? Yeah. But of course you take more concern about water, the moisture and so on, but it's not impossible. And then in that hotel, they even put the minibar inside the bathroom, which is very practical for me for a hotel, because when you're in the bathroom, you want to drink. You don't want to go back to the bedroom to get a bottle of champagne, and so why not? So as a result, I think it's a very smart idea. With 32 square meter room, you got a real luxurious bathroom with wardrobe and minibar. Okay, the last part is, as I mentioned earlier, prefabrication. So I encourage you to study further. Okay, after all this, I very, very quick trip through our relevant projects. I believe some of you may know already. We start out with something not too small. It's 250 square meter. But with the idea of transformation to another extreme. So this is the suitcase house in Beijing. To be more precise, along the Great Wall of China. done 30 years ago. So the idea is, I skip the details. So our house is in at the entrance. It's not too small, it's 250 square meters, but the idea is play hide and seek. So where are the lady stuff? It's like an empty house. Actually, it's a very easy concept. We did the concept within half a day, talking with my colleagues, Alicia, right? Because we want to hide all the stuff you need for a home. Actually, it's a hotel. So bathroom, bed, where should we put them? So and in a very short time, we decided to put it all onto the floor. So this is a kind of a raised floor system, but not for electrical mechanical means, but for furniture. This is actually the scenario like most when the house is totally empty. And the concept is like the house is like a box with different compartments into the floor. It's altogether 54 panels, which can open and close, hiding everything you need in the home, like a farm and so on. But the trick is so interesting because mathematically you have amazing number of possibilities simply by opening or closing different floor panels. So this, as I said, this is a floor panel I like most when it's empty. Interesting concept is when it's empty, it could be anything because it's empty. Yeah. When it's empty, you don't see where is the bathroom, where it's totally empty, simply. So you can start to imagine other activities. Another strange thing happens afterwards. When I visited the general manager of the hotel, he told me that, you know, your house during the daytime, during the nighttime after dinner is for social dance. And then during the daytime is a yoga center. So my home suddenly become a multifunctional room. So this is a section of the house showing the 1 meter deep raised floor compartment inside the floor. The most striking thing has become real. Actually, I'm quite lucky. After working for present for 20 years, I still haven't got a chance to do a house. But then this was the first house design, which could be so experimental. It's still there, but you should not stay there. It's in a very rundown condition. I think it's still possible to visit, but they didn't open the floor anymore. They put it a cupboard, unfortunately. But you can see the transformation. The floor start to open up. I call it a chat room or music room. And this is the biggest floor that opened up and closing a pantry. So it's perfect for lazy people because after cooking, you just simply close the floor and imagine it doesn't exist. So you need the washing for the day after. So. And all these things are very personal, they all relate to me. I'm very lazy, as I said. And I hate washing dishes. So, yeah, I got the very generous type room. It's 3 meters. When you go down, it becomes 4 meters. Actually, on plan, it's not quite tight, but in reality, it's not that tight. Again, think about three dimensions. Don't just look at the floor plans. You'll get stuck. So this resembles kind of like a bedroom. And including the bed is also openable from a hinge floor panel. When you look more closely, the bed resembles a coffin. Timber outside and velvet inside. Yeah. But to be honest, after all these years, it still functions as a hotel. Unless the general manager didn't tell me, because up till now, nobody complained. It looked like a coffin. Because you look more carefully, it's quite romantic. It's a double bed coffin. So you can try to experience staying in a coffin with your partner. So nobody complained. Yeah. People are curious. Maybe life in a coffin. What would it be like here? Yeah. On the left hand side is our project architect, Andy. So he's very obsessed about project, he can do anything. So this is when it's almost finished. You can see another important thing is you can explore. It's again the idea of the guideline menu. So one object for two functions or two surfaces. Because when you open the floor before is a floor. Now when you open up, it becomes a double-sided wall. So you are increasing the surface area by you double in this case, or triple you can say, depending on how you are organizing. So you actually one very important thing or effective thing about compact home is we try to, by whatever means, expand the surface area. Because what you need at the end is in a lot of cases is about the surface area. So this is a very straightforward way to expand the surface. And actually this later become a mirror. And I put the shower head on the floor, not become the wall. Sounds very complicated. Yeah. And at night, again, with the effect of lighting, you can totally mean something very surreal. You cannot tell what this space is. It doesn't resemble any part of the home, but it still works as a home, at least for temporary home. And when you want to do a more cozy dinner space, you just open the wall to enclose the space more. This is totally surreal. It doesn't feel like anything. As I said, since it doesn't look like anything, it could be anything. This is a very important message. We have a company holiday. So have fun. Okay, back to 32. It's the Stockholm project. It calls the Terrace Tower. And I'm very surprised the first project we realized outside Greater China is from Stockholm. I thought it's New York or London, but strange enough it's Sweden. When you had the chance to visit Sweden and Stockholm especially, you can imagine. Yeah, it's actually they got very good economy. Europe is not too good at the moment. But in Sweden it's a very good economy. You will see a lot of cranes, like not as much as Berlin 20 years ago, but still you see a lot of cranes. So the economy is really good. It's like one of the epic centers. And it's no joking, they are in shortage of supply for the demand. And one area our developers think about is they have shortage of small units. Yeah, they recognize it's a big need. And similar to the, I think you all know the Michael laws in New York, that competition initiated by Bloomberg, the former mayor. So New York originally had the standard, the regulation of 400 square feet as a minimum home. Now, in this particular project, the former mayor tried to organize a competition and lowering the minimum size of the home to 250 square feet. So this proves especially that the phenomenon is global now. But I'm still surprised that our project is in Stockholm. And then this project, this tower is nothing ordinary, it's 70 story high. You start to curious why in Sweden you needed such a tall building. And it worked like a hotel with facilities and so on. Rooftop swimming pool. But then the strange thing to me is the entire building is small units. Because with the same tower in Hong Kong, I'm sure they will have a penthouse on the top, which costs crazy. But in this project, they still want to develop the entire project out of small units. Maybe there's something about Sweden. I think Sweden is a very socialist country, I recall. So they always talk about fairness. Even among the Scandinavian countries, I think Sweden is, correct me if I'm wrong, I feel that Sweden is, every time they talk about fairness, so everyone is the same. So maybe it's still true at the end that the entire building is built out of small units. So this is the early concept of the architect. And actually there are two units. I'll show you this is the most important, the typical floor plan. On each floor there are 10 units. Either is in the middle, 6 unit is 32. By the way, it's exactly the size of my home in the same configuration. I'm sure they borrow my idea. And then the corner are a bit bigger, 44. So either 32 or 44. And maybe because of that, they have to fly to Hong Kong to meet me. And they gave us a project to do the interior of the apartment. So the architect's original idea is he has a term called creative wall. So on each apartment, when you buy the apartment, it's equipped with a wall which are fully furbished here. But then the rest of the space is you can do it yourself. So to me, this is more realistic than fully furbished, as I said earlier. So this is our contribution to the creative wall. Oh, by the way, all these projects are confidential, so I hope you selectively forget about it. So no photos, please. It's like a show in a nightclub. No photos, no video taking. So to give you very quickly the idea, so in a compact wall, we try to squeeze in everything we need for a home, especially the difficult part. So you can imagine what you can put into an entire wall, which is actually some most of the problems. And they even have a mock-up done in northern Sweden, which is they are very happy about. Well, if you start thinking of, actually, the simple idea is, if you find an empty wall in your home, you feel regret. How come it's empty? Yeah, so think about it more carefully. So Smolan is 55, it's a Bangalore project. Maybe when it is this thing. Okay, so this project is not too small, but it's very demanding because in India it's a different mentality. They are talking about apartment for the whole lifespan. That means they want the home to buy a home which suits the purpose for the entire family, from 2 to 8. Crazy. You know, if you know India, you know they always have big families. I remember when I did this project when I visited Bangalore, the design director showed me his home. So this is my father, this is my uncle, this is my relative. So they all live together. It's not joking. So for this 50 square meter home, they talk about maximum number of 8 people. So again, they need transformation. It's not too small, but it's still talk about transformation. So the main idea is apartment which can transform to allow for more people live inside. I don't mention too much detail, so this is the basic idea. So we still talk about the idea of modular transformation, off-site construction, and how to cater for of a growth family from just married to have a big family without home design or city design. Again, actually, they raise a very important question which they still demand, but they understand it's very difficult, especially with the tight budget. Again, acoustic isolation, yeah, which is very difficult. Yeah. So I think they have to learn to whisper again. So that is, in short, the idea of how the home could transform by movable wall. Actually, it doesn't mean that you have a new member, you've got one more room. Actually, it's also suits for daily purpose. When you don't need a room for sleeping, you can enlarge the living room. And in extreme case, you know, in India, yeah, like New Year, you can have one whole apartment for a feast, yeah, with a big dining table also. So that's the rough idea. Our contractor is already checking this mechanism in Dongguan, in China already. Okay. Now is the optimum, 15 square meter, which you are all welcome to visit. It's already open. It's a Henderson project, so the place is, the exhibition is in Miramar Mall on the 5th floor. You can visit anytime, it's already there. So actually, I can tell you all the major developers in Hong Kong are developing this concept of ultra compact home in the area of 15 square meter. That means around 180 square feet. Every major developer is talking about this. But I think Henderson is, they are more sincere. They invite us, they commission us to do a study more than 1 year ago. So we are offer the job to do a study on this 15 square meter home. And they, of course, it's a study, so it's not a real site at the beginning. So they asked us to test the proportion, what would be the optimum. So our findings is, I don't know whether we have the chart or not, but maybe I'll tell you verbally, that we find out the optimum proportion for a 15 square meter home is roughly around 2.45 meter wide to 6.5 meter long. Because, yeah, if the apartment is longer, you got more surface, but then you are not able to squeeze in the bed. But if it's too narrow or too square, you don't have enough surface to put on all the furniture. Yeah, so our optimum size is roughly around 2.5 meter wide. This is our findings. And they, you know, Hong Kong mentality. The developers, at first, actually they cheated us. At the beginning, they said it's a study. But then after half a year, they said it's a real project. So they now apply to the real project. And you know they have so many projects, so they check which is the most relevant project. Now it become a project for in Homan team. I think it's called, I forgot the name.
Number 7?
Homan team, I think. Something like that. So, and this is like their testing ground, so they release only one unit for sale. Yeah. And this is fully published. So in this 15 square meter space roughly, you can see it's 2.45 by 5.3 actually.
5.2.
5.2. Am I correct?
Yeah.
So we are able to squeeze in everything we need. Even at the beginning, we are able to put in the queen size bed. And we are able to put in also a mini wine cellar for 6 bottles.
Yeah. So,
so living in a compact space doesn't mean that you have to compromise the comfort and lifestyle. Yeah. And well, at the end it worked. Yeah. But don't give me an even smaller space, as I said. Yeah. To me, it's the ultimate already, almost. Yeah. So this is the mock-up you see at the site. Without, I encourage you to visit the real place, it's even better. Yeah. So that's the idea. And actually, I could tell you one thing. One of the most important things in this apartment is we have a pair of sliding doors enclosing the unit in the middle. As a result, the bathroom and the wardrobe are into one space. Yeah. And you've got the luxury of changing your clothes within the bathroom, which originally is the corridor. So again, it's a time-based design. So without the details, I encourage you to visit the place to explore more. So the model is splendid. So maybe you should say something. Yeah, of your, because you spend almost one whole night there taking photos. You should know whether the unit is good or not. Well, actually, I've been working in this profession for 43 years, but I didn't know this actually a product that you can squeeze out an iron board and turn 90 degrees. It's actually proprietary. Then, yeah, demonstrate the bathroom. And the bathroom, you can open the floor so that you can come with a shower chair at the below. Yeah. So it's nothing new. Actually, my friends in Europe have all these strategies. Yeah. So that is, to me, it's like the upgrade version of the Filipinos made bathroom. You know, having a safe space for shower and toilet is very difficult. The place gets wet, it's difficult to use afterwards. So we try and kind of solve this problem by having a double floor. And also we have a glass door that encloses the toilet, which won't get wet during the shower. And the size is actually quite generous. One thing is we put a coffee machine at the entrance and a wash basin so that when you open, so it's not just about storage, it's also about heavy things also. I think this is psychological to me. Yeah. And we know it's a challenge to put in so many things, but don't spend all your time solving the problem, don't it? But at least a space needs to be happy. It doesn't occupy much space. Yeah. So it turned out to be quite practical. Yeah. Again, this is the main problem is you don't have much space for your personal belongings. That's the problem. Yeah. You have to think about it, how to do it. Yeah. We are trying to incorporate as many storage spaces as possible, but I still feel in reality it's far from enough. Yeah, we have the movable furniture and so on. Movie? We sell movie. And this unit is quite special, you got a big terrace. Yeah, so. Are you joking? So yes, we just finished a project in Shanghai, but it's actually a Xing'an International Sculptural Festival. So we did a sculpture. But in the name of Carpet Home again. So it's still there until end of the month, but I think the exhibition will extend a little bit more. So if you are in Shanghai before 20th of November, you can still visit. So this is an opportunity for us to explore the idea that I always ask, how small your home could be? Yeah. At the moment it's 15. But what happens if it's getting smaller? What happens if it's 10? But if you are knowledgeable enough, you know the capsule tower in Tokyo, which is 10.4 square meter. Yeah. And it's been home for many people for, the building was done in the 70s, yeah. So 40 years. And actually I stayed there one night, yeah, because one apartment is an Airbnb, but it's very dirty. You have to have some preparation, yeah. So it's very dirty, I can understand it. But you still have the chance to visit, yeah. So in this particular exhibition, we did two 10 square meter home. One is about the catchment belonging. Yeah, you said the home is very small, it's 10 square meter. But in case of the catchment, it's talk about 8 people's home in the same area. So we are not talking about 10 is not that small in that respect. Yeah. So you are encouraged to experience the cagement in this installation. And the other home is kind of abstract, because in this exhibition, since it's a sculpture exhibition, I don't want to have a real solution. So we just put a minimal furniture inside and let you experience what is life about living in a 10 square meter home. So this is actually quite a smart function, incorporating a bed, a desk, and chair together. Actually, the end part of the bed is very practical, especially when you stay cozy. You know, because of hygiene, one of the areas that you can trust is clean enough is the bed, because they change the sheet every day almost, at least when you check in. Hopefully it's clean. So actually most people do their activity on the bed, yeah. So all everything, they believe it's clean enough, yeah. So the end part of the bed is actually a very good area for other purposes. So this is the exhibition. And then one of our conclusion is why your home could be so small, because maybe your home is not your home, the city is your home, because you are tapping on the resources of the entire city. So this is our conclusion.